Thank you very much, Ambassador Chinoy, General Malik, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here at IDSA because it's always good coming back to IDSA, but even more so today because both Sujan and General Malik are old friends with whom I've had the good fortune of working together with on very critical issues. I'm glad General Malik spoke before me because many of the points that I may have mentioned he did, and I'm completely supportive of everything that he said. We work together, so the outlook is the same. As you are aware, this was a very unusual, once in a lifetime perhaps, conflict. It was fought from early May onwards through till 26 July 1999, across a front of about 150 kilometers, at dizzying heights, in some cases 18,000 feet, and it really goes down as perhaps the most inhospitable and unlikely battlegrounds of history. The relatively rapid expulsion of the Pakistani forces from the heights at which they had entered through stealth was amazing. And the credit for this goes in the main to our soldiers, both officers and men. The victory didn't come cheap. We lost over 500 soldiers and men, and I think more than double that number were injured. On the Pakistani side, however, the casualties were much higher, and even a conservative estimate would put it at double that number. There are some Pakistani estimates which go up to 4,000. My perspectives on the Kargil war are largely informed by the fact that I was Member Secretary of the Kargil Review Committee, which was set up in end July 1999 with the mandate to review the events leading up to the conflict and to make recommendations to safeguard national security against similar intrusions. Given this type of a remit, the committee did not look at how the conflict was handled post 26th May 1999, when we decided to use AIPA. A word or two about the committee itself. It functioned in a spirit of openness and transparency, and this was in large measure due to the other members of the committee, notably the late K. Subramaniam, chairman and doyen of India's Strategic Fraternity, the meticulous General Hazari, former Vice Chief of Army Staff, and the late B.G. Varghese, one of our most respected and versatile journalists and thinkers. One would be remiss if I did not also mention the role of the then National Security Advisor, Mr. Brijesh Mishra, who greatly facilitated the task of the committee. It was because of his wholehearted support that the entire national establishment in India opened itself up into interactions with the committee members. Moreover, he also gave the committee a complete carte blanche in the manner in which it went about its work and what its recommendations and findings were. There was zero interference. And here I may relate a small episode in the final stages of the committee's work when I told him in one of our numerous meetings that, sir, the committee is going to make a recommendation that the office of Principal Secretary to PM and NSA, both of which were occupied by him, should be separated. He simply smiled and he said, go ahead. There was no effort to dilute, change anything, even one that affected him personally. The committee, in going about its work, consciously decided that it would not get into the act of scapegoating anyone for any individual for any shortcoming. Its objective was to work in a cooperative mode to draw out people so that it could derive appropriate lessons and come to the right conclusions. In the process, it had in-depth interactions with scores of politicians, military personnel, ranging from the lowest officers, lieutenants in Kargil, whom we met, to the chiefs, from senior civil servants, with journalists, with the public. It met everyone, and there's reams of paper in terms of annexures in the report. It's also important to keep in mind that the work was finished in super quick time. The committee was set up in end July. The report was submitted on 15 December 1999. Credit should also go to the government of the day for doing something totally unusual. The report was made public. Hitherto, you know about 1962, 65, 71, so on and so forth, Henderson Brooks, etc., etc. These reports were not really published. This report was published, and the only pity is that the reams and reams of annexures were not published. Those were kept back by the government. I do hope they would publish those, so that the work of people like Colonel Chadha is made much easier and would be much more productive. The main elements of the report, apart from the recommendations, included, inter alia, the nature of the Pakistani action, its authors, the motivations, the nature of our response till 26th May, our so-called intelligence failure, on which General Malik and I have had many interactions, and speculation on whether or not this conflict was avoidable and could have been avoided. So coming to Pakistani action, stealth, secrecy, deception were the hallmarks of the Pakistani intrusions in Kargil. The exercise was therefore taken with virtually no movement of additional formations from outside the sector. There was also no extraordinary dumping of stores, etc. It involved a relatively small number of personnel, 1,500 to 2,000, across a frontage of around 150 or 120 km, in relatively shallow depths, around 5 km. Movement of the personnel was undertaken in deep winter, from January to April 1999. By end April, they had more or less completed what they planned to do. And this happened because patrolling of our forces was virtually impossible at those heights. And many of the posts were traditionally vacated at that time of the year. Finally, as George Verghese put it in one of the areas in the report which he wrote, which we wrote up, he said these guys came in fancy dress, masquerading as Mujahideen and terrorists. The Kargil intrusion was part of a plan formulated in Pakistan Army headquarters in the 80s, but it was never executed. The author of this exercise, as General Malik rightly said, was Musharraf, who had been made Chief of Army Staff by Nawaz Sharif in October 1998 over the heads of two other more senior generals. Even within Pakistan, knowledge of this operation was confined to a very small coterie of generals around Musharraf on a need-to-know basis. Neither the Air Force nor their Navy was kept in the loop. It is also uncertain as to how much Nawaz himself knew of this exercise. The committee took the stand, and I'm quoting from the committee's report, "The balance of possibility suggests that he was fully in the picture." The committee then went on to assert that he was at least aware of the broad thrust of the plan when Mr. Vajpayee went to Lahore in February 1999. So that was the sort of approach that the committee took, but there are many contradictory views on this issue, and I think it's not a certainty whether he knew it or not. Clearly, the Pakistani intrusion was well planned and well executed, provided it was to be a limited, once-off tactical surprise package. It certainly completely surprised India. By end April, the Pakistani forces had occupied many of the high points across the frontage I referred to without detection. Furthermore, even after detection, and here again, the general is absolutely right, in the second week of May, we believed that what we confronted were militants and not the Pakistan army. It was not until a few weeks later, after active engagement with the intruders, that we realized that what we were up against were not militants, but the Pakistan army. It is true that there were some militants embedded with this infiltration force, but these were in the nature of support elements. And it was estimated that the bulk of the intruders, by the time we got to know, were regular Pakistan army forces, and the militants numbered no more than perhaps around 30%. I would here like to depart a little bit from the Kargil Review Committee report and relate to you what I came to know in my official capacity very early in the second week of May about this entire thing. At that time, I was chairman Joint Intelligence Committee, and we used to have regular meetings with members of the intelligence services. There were, if I recall right, four agencies represented, and I will not name them, at that meeting. Two of them said, "Sir, there has been a fairly large intrusion of some scores of people into India," and promptly the other two agencies pounced upon them and said, "No way. This hasn't happened." So I was in a quandary, and I said, "I want all of you to very quickly get together and let me know what is the correct position, so that our job is to provide assessed intelligence to the government of India. How can I make an assessment when two agencies are completely opposing what you are saying?" This is very early in the second week of May, somewhere around 10th or 11th. Before they could get back to me, this had become public in terms of intimations about it. And we are aware now that on the 3rd of May, the first intimations from an informer, a shepherd in fact, had come to the Indian Army at the front, and patrols were sent. And I think within 3-4 days after that, there was contact established that yes, there has been an intrusion. But still, the thought was that it is Mujahideen elements, because they were wearing Mujahideen dress. Pakistani motivations and assumptions, the general referred to that, and the Kargil Review Committee took the view And I think this is borne out by subsequent developments and assertions that it was clearly motivated, Musharraf has said it himself, was motivated by the desire to internationalize the Kashmir issue as a nuclear flashpoint. This they had always wanted to do and encourage third party intervention to alter the LOC and use the areas captured as a possible trade-off against Indian positions on Siachen. Only recently, Najam Sethi was saying that this was revenge for Siachen. So, you know, this is further corroboration of that. Interdict the Srinagar-Leh road and provide a fillip to the insurgency in Kashmir. There were two or three assumptions in the Pakistani mind when they undertook this exercise. These were that early third-party intervention would take place in Pakistan's favor, thereby enabling it to retain position of the areas captured by it, enabling it to bargain from a position of strength. This was a very clear assumption that was there. And this was in the backdrop of our having gone nuclear, which General Malik had mentioned in May 1998, and Pakistan having done so, we having become pariah states in a way, and the world whipping up this bogey of a nuclear war in the region. So that was the backdrop. Also, the second assumption was that Pakistan's nuclear capability would obviate any larger Indian riposte across the IB or even the use of air power. Third, India would not be in a position to mount a swift and resolute response due to a number of factors. There were a number of things that were there. It was felt India would not be able to do this. In the event, as we noticed, as the events unfolded, most of these assumptions were wrong, except possibly cross-IB retaliation and also restrained use of air power. Do not cross the LOC, and our Air Force was really put in a straitjacket by our political leadership by asking them not to cross the LOC. If Pakistan took India by surprise by occupying the heights, the Kargil heights, through stealth and deception, I think India took them even more by surprise with its very swift and very effective retaliation, which ultimately compelled it to vacate aggression. Even if one looks back over time, this is not the first occasion on which Pakistan has underestimated the Indian response. This happened in 47. It happened in 65. It happened during what the director referred to, the surgical strikes of 2016. It happened at Balakot. Why do these miscalculations happen by Pakistan again and again and again? In my view, this is firstly because, and I've lived in Pakistan for a large part of my career, actually I am from that side also, but I've served there for about 5.5 or 6 years in different capacities, is there is a deep contempt for the Hindu India. There's a very deep contempt. And Musharraf had a great deal of this. So did Ayub Khan's son, because I've interacted with these people. Ek dhakka do, wo gir jayenge. This is the mindset, and they will not respond aggressively. It's partly our fault also, because we have taken, I will not use the four-letter word, but we have taken so much from Pakistan without responding. So we have actually reinforced this fallacious thought process in their minds by our own inaction. Okay, India's response, I think General Malik covered this very well. Following this detection of intrusions in the second week of May, the Indian response was extremely prompt and effective. A comprehensive set of actions which he detailed were initiated to establish contact with the intruders, to fix them in terms of the extent of intrusion and to contain them and to take them on. Adequate troops and firepower were provided. There was a lot of troop movement. We also had the Siachen troops coming down at that point in time, which was Fort Vitus, which were also put into this sector. And there was sufficient, due to planning by the armed forces, sufficient, not perfect, but adequate extreme winter clothing, etc., that is required, that was there. We actually interviewed people and we were told about this. Appropriate coverings were, moves were made, as the general mentioned, by the army as well as by the navy. This was also undertaken. And of course, the use of air power was sanctioned. India's moves were well understood and respected by the international community. And in the event, it is a combination of these factors which secured Pakistan's total retreat in the area. I may like to mention, and here again digress a little bit from the report, is that through the course of the Kargil conflict, there were two groups which were constantly working and providing behind the scenes suggestions and advice to the government in the manner in which we should conduct ourselves. One was a very small subgroup of the NSAB, which was chaired by the late Mr. J.N. Dixit. It was a four-member group which used to meet in my room three or four times a week. And after the discussions, I would dictate the conclusions of that report after getting the okay of the chairman, and it would go right up to the top. A second group was ourselves in the NSCS, because we were also doing a shadow exercise and we'd been asked that please provide your inputs as to what should be done. Now, one of the main things that animated both these groups was a very deep anxiety that, given the location of the Pakistani troops, it would be very, very difficult to secure the early vacation of those Kargil Heights. And in the process, we would take very heavy casualties. So both groups came up with recommendations that we need to widen the envelope and take action so that the Pakistanis are compelled to vacate aggression. The Dixit subgroup's recommendations were very heavy use of air power across the LOC and to cut off lines of communication and cause damage on the other side so that there is real pain. The NSCS group's recommendations were that we need to widen the envelope either across the LOC or even the IB through use of conventional forces. And you heard what the general said. They had prepared for an offensive action if need be. So the recommendation from the NSCS group was that we need to use that. We did not look at air power, but we looked at conventional forces. None of these recommendations or suggestions gained any traction, and we engaged in a conventional slugfest with Pakistan in the Kargil sector, and we took casualties, heavy casualties. However, we got them out much sooner than expected. I said 26 July, there was a diplomatic factor at play also there. But whatever it may be, with hindsight, one could say that the diplomatic factor was perhaps at the back of the mind of our leadership. Possibly they rightly felt that the support that we enjoyed from the US specifically would diminish if we crossed the IB or the LOC. And that's why the words, you would all have heard it, maintain sanctity of LOC, maintain sanctity of LOC. It was repeated ad nauseum through those months and weeks. So that is that. I mentioned earlier so-called intelligence failure through the conflict and its aftermath. Much of India's so-called intelligence factor was in the news, both in terms of delayed detection and not able to detect the nature of the intrusion. Army, not militants. Of course, it's true we were caught unawares. And to that extent, yes, it is true it was a failure of intelligence. But I think, which the general hinted upon but is important, due consideration should be given to the fact that detection of this type of an operation doesn't come easy. In the absence of very high quality surveillance capabilities and the sheer inability to mount patrols in that area where we could see them. And actually, we interviewed commanders, majors, lieutenant colonels in the area, and they said, "Sir, we did try to send out patrols. This is our diary. Please have a look at it." He could proceed 300, 400, 500 meters, and then there's a problem. There's 18-foot deep snow out there sinking into the wretched thing. So there were problems. Furthermore, as I see it, and this is my assessment, it was virtually impossible to foresee it because it defied logic. He said unconventional. It was a high-risk, low-reward exercise. And actually, it carried within it the seeds of its own defeat, and prudence would have militated against such an exercise. High risk because it was launched in deep winter, prone to very heavy casualties. And we read the diaries of soldiers on the Pakistan side, which we got, indicating that they had had heavy losses in the avalanches which were taking place there. And they were lucky. Had they been detected, there would have been sure death for those people in terms of bombing. Low reward, because this intrusion could not possibly have been sustained. There was, as I said initially, there was virtually no movement from outside of additional forces. To sustain this operation, you needed much more movement of forces. So it was a non-sustainable exercise. In fact, General Ali Kuli Khan, who was superseded, so there is probably a personal angle in this, I don't discount it, but he is certainly reputed to have been, Ranga would have known him, he's in Pakistan too. I had met him, but he was one of those superseded by Musharraf. And he has damned this entire operations. It's worth a quote. And he went on to state that its conception at the highest level had been poor. In fact, so poor that the only word which can adequately describe it is unprofessional. We all know that the main duty of high command is to ensure with meticulous planning that they create conditions whereby their junior combatants can fight easily. This was not done at Kargil. It was also fairly obvious that the Kargil operation was not conceived in its totality. I said it's a tactical operation only. And it has brought ignominy to Pakistan. As far as the committee, and I come back to that, is concerned, it primarily held RNAW responsible for the intelligence failure, but it qualified it. and it said that it had not detected a change in the deployment of battalions in the area, more specifically the addition of one battalion to the force level normally deployed there. So actually RNAW got the names of the battalions wrong. It did not know which battalion was there. The numbers was more or less right to the extent of one battalion. It erred on it that it isn't there. It held MI responsible also, but to a much lesser extent, and it's written as much, for not detecting the intrusions on the grounds, because obviously the army was up front. And this was the criticism which all of you will remember was made. The army was there, it didn't see it. My response to that is, how could the army see it? Because the army wasn't up front, those posts were vacated. And as the general mentioned, there were some areas which were kept taken vacant because there were smaller elements. Force levels, you could not get in through those. Could Kargil have been avoided? The committee felt clearly that this could have been prevented had the army done what the general was saying it didn't do, namely to plaster itself across the entire border. It could have been avoided, but it found that this is not the same thing to do. Actually, this is a sure prescription for a destruction of an army. I go even further. It shouldn't be involved in border guarding at all. That's my view. Because you really damage your army's fighting capabilities. It is meant to take on the enemy in a hot war. If you are keeping them in the front all the time, there is debilitation. And I can afford to be more frank than General Malik on some of these matters. I feel very strongly this is not a thing for the army to do. Recommendations. And here I'll ask the director. I'm at 11:30. I've done my 30 minutes. We can have the recommendations in question answer, or would you like me to mention some of them? Depends on how quickly you can. 5 minutes. Okay. See, my equations with Mr. Chinoy, they go back to New York. Okay. UL timelines. Yes, I'm used to that. Okay. Recommendations. The committee made about 24 recommendations. And I'll only mention one of those. I will put the others in question answer because they are lengthy and there can be more, and I would address it more adequately thereafter. The single most important recommendation was to undertake a thorough review of the national security system in its entirety by an independent body of credible experts. This recommendation was immediately taken up by the government of India at the time, and a group of ministers was constituted under the Home Minister, and its task was to review the entire security system. It was constituted in April 2000, and within just over 13 months it submitted its reports to government, which was accepted in toto, barring the recommendations pertaining to the CDS. I'll come to that. How did the group of ministers go about this job? They didn't conjure it up in the Home Minister's lovely room in North Block. They constituted 4 task forces. One on internal security, which was chaired by Mr. Vora. One on border management, which was chaired by Mr. Godbole. One on higher defense management, which was chaired by Arun Singh. And one on intelligence, which was Mike Saxena. So these task forces, and each of them had about 8 or 10 experts. Most of the experts were from outside the system. Many retired people, but serving people were hardly any, except on the defense one there were. These 4 task forces submitted their reports, and the group of ministers had in-depth discussions with the chairman of each of these task forces, and each of those recommendations was questioned, analyzed, assessed, and so on. And on the basis of that discussions, the group of ministers came up with a list of 350 recommendations. The recommendations, actually, after each meeting, I was the secretary of that committee also. After each meeting, the record was prepared, got approved. So it was relatively easy for me to do it because they were very prompt in the action taken. And the approvals came very fast. So we had these 350 recommendations, which were accepted. The major recommendation in these, as I said, was the CDS. And I had had interactions with Mr. Vajpayee on the recommendations before we went to the CCS. And he seemed to be okay with every one of those recommendations, including the CDS. Except on a few minutes before the last, the CCS meeting, it was on 15th May, I think, 2001, when he said, there is no political consensus and we should put this on hold. So CDS and four or five related recommendations were on hold. The rest were accepted. And my clear impression is that this hold came because the Congress government was unwilling on the CDS issue. This was substantiated because when there was a change of regime, I came into the new regime also with Mr. Dixit then as NSA. And I told him, I said, sir, we are suffering. We need this. Congress was not willing. And that's where it happened. A final word before I stop, because I'm getting to my 5 minutes, is as regards the other recommendations, at least till the time I was there, which was February 2005, when I demitted office, we did a quarterly monitoring of each recommendation. By the time I left, around 50% had actually been implemented. The balance still were not. And it is my view that had those, all of them been done sincerely and with the dispatch that was required, many of the problems that we face in India, which are security related, would not have happened. Certainly Mumbai would not have happened. And the armed forces and the military personnel, paramilitaries, the police would have been much more effective forces than they are today. But I promised him 11:35. It is 11:35. I have some more recommendations after tea. I would be prepared to stay on if you want to go into the others, but I won't take more time. Thank you for the patience.